Hey, this is Eli with a little update on the food forest here in Jacksonville, Florida. We are in Southside, Jacksonville, Florida, which is in the urban core, about 12 miles inland from the ocean. We've created a food forest. We're going on to 4 years. There's over 55 varieties of fruit trees planted in this green mess you see behind me. There's lots of plants that are purposefully planted for biomass production, and that's what this video is kind of about. We're going to go in and cut some things down and mulch some things. We call it chop and drop in the permaculture world. There's lots of edibles that you're looking at right now behind me as well. Moringa trees are the tallest ones you see, and all parts of the tree are edible. There's lots of beans growing. There's lots of lemongrass and just different crops. And a lot of it was designed in to actually produce fertility, because that's what we're after here. We're after building soil. We want plants that grow quick. We can cut them and they grow right back. We cut them again and we just keep mulching that stuff back, and we build soil, and we've done a pretty good job at it. We have very sandy soils here in Northeast Florida. It's like a mineral sand, it's like a fine sugar sand. Last time we filmed, it was last spring, and the entire summer and spring has passed and we're into the autumn, and this is a good time to do some fall maintenance. So we've been really working on that, creating soil, and we're going to get in here and do some chopping and dropping to show you what that looks like. What we have here are some simple hand tools, and you know, if you spend the extra money in the beginning and get really nice tools, they last forever with very little maintenance. This is just a machete. It's a woodsman's pal. It's a really nice little machete. It's shorter, easier to carry around. And then this is for kind of like the heavier chopping kind of stuff we have to do. We don't use any mechanical equipment. I mean, nothing that runs on any kind of petroleum product here.
This is a sickle. It's one of my favorite garden tools. It's really, really handy for just cutting back cover crops, tall grass, herbaceous things that you're gonna cut and mulch back into the soil.
Very efficient, very cheap. You could get these things for like $3 all day long on the internet. They work really good and they're really sharp. And we have this tool here.
Pruners. This one's called Wicked. It's a wicked tree saw. It's got a lifetime guarantee on the handle, and it works really well. And the great thing about this is you can stick it in this pouch here and it doesn't come out. So if you're climbing upside down in trees, and you need it to saw, and you're able to pull it out.
So if you like to go inverted, that saw is where it's at.
And then our last little tool is just some sort of pruners. Always very handy, you know,
These are relatively small pruners. It's got a micro tip on it, a serrated blade on there too. Pretty handy stuff, but real simple. That's how we like to keep it here, is really simple. So we're gonna work on this moringa tree that you just saw. It's really tall and really skinny, and it probably should have been pruned earlier on in the season, and then it would have grown a little bit more bushy, but it doesn't matter. We can cut it down now, and we can harvest the greens to eat, but we probably will just mulch them because we have plenty of moringa everywhere. So we're probably just gonna mulch this one and not really harvest any leaves. We'll harvest the whole entire tree for our fruit trees to eat and not us, because our fruit trees need food as well.
And they have a growth factor hormone in them, so giving it back to our food forest hopefully will give it added minerals and a little bit of a punch to help everything grow in this winter season. So this is about good. We cut it a little bit above the node, where a bud. There you go. Then we just break off branches really easily.
So these are the moringa leaves, and you can eat them. They have kind of a mustardy flavor about them. But we're gonna mulch them. We have plenty of this stuff around. What we do is we'll take the tree, and moringa is a really soft kind of tree. Makes you feel like Superman when you're breaking it into pieces.
Superwoman too.
Or Superwoman. So you can see the front here. We'll just break it down into little pieces. This is a strawberry guava, or no, pineapple guava, and there's sweet potatoes growing at the bottom of it, and we could just throw this right on top of the sweet potatoes because their season's about to end anyway, so we can mulch this back And then you can end up still digging up the potatoes.
And these bigger pieces are also good just to stick them right in the ground. And moringa has, like we were saying earlier, it has this growth hormone in it, and it just starts to grow really easily, even from such a big cutting.
So this is the piece we just cut, and as long as it's still green underneath this layer of bark here, this thing will continue to grow, or it has the potential to grow. And if you just use a pocket knife or your fingernail and just give it a little scrape and you could see green down there, you're good to go. And this thing is ready to plant, and you could just literally bury it in the ground just like this, and it should grow out of every little node.
Yeah, so I mean, with moringa, you don't have to put it very far in the ground actually, but probably about a foot, and try and bury two nodes, and you should have really good success. They work much better with a bigger piece than little pieces for moringa, actually.
And like I said, they plant these just like this in Saudi Arabia in the driest climate I've ever seen. It's on the YouTube. There's a permaculture project going on. I can't remember the name of it offhand. We'll post a link below where they just stick these things in the ground. Totally desert sand, absolutely no nutrients, absolutely no organic material. And these things just thrive out there, and they only have brackish water to irrigate them with, and they do fine with brackish water. So this is a very important crop for the world, especially in areas that don't have fresh water and areas that are desertified already, which is a lot and growing. So we're just gonna prune this branch really quick. You can see it, just really short work, really easy. And it doesn't have to be in tiny little pieces, but the smaller you chop it up, the quicker it will break down. The tree doesn't care either way. I look at it as long-term fertility throughout the winter, and all of this will be converted into humus, which this pineapple guava can actually use for nutrition. So it's a good time to do it is in the fall, so it rots down over the winter for a spring flush.
And also we're waiting for the rains to subside a bit, because I didn't want to chop and drop the moringa while it was raining every, you know, kind of heavily for a few weeks for us, and that would just kind of rot out the moringa a little bit. So we were waiting for at least a dry day.
Yeah, and you could see this is a decent bit of mulch, but we'll even go thicker on certain fruit trees. Certain trees need more nutrition than other trees. This is another tree that we planted here specifically to chop down seasonally. It's called Acacia pendula, and it's about to bloom, and I really like its flowers, so it's a bummer we have to cut some of it. But this tree right here is a nectarine tree. You can barely see it. And the nectarine tree needs some fertilizer, so we've planted this next to the tree for a couple of reasons: to cut it and mulch it, and also this tree produces nitrogen. It pulls it out of the atmosphere and it puts it in the root zone with an association with some bacteria that's in the soil to actually release nitrogen. So when we cut this tree, it's going to actually release nitrogen into the soil to where this nectarine tree can actually get it. And at the same time, we're going to be adding more organic material around this tree, which is going to turn into fertilizer for this tree.
Okay, so I do a little undercut first to make it easier at the very end for when the branch is falling off. And then we'll just cut it right here. It's a little harder than the moringa, but you just keep going.
So we're just gonna cut this thing up into little pieces with a machete. And you know, it's nothing hard, a few swipes, anyone can really do this. There's all kinds of stuff growing here. There's goji berries and sweet potato on the ground as a ground cover. There's marigold, Mexican marigold. There's African blue basil, which is an edible crop, very aromatic. And what we're gonna do is, this is a black locust tree, which is another type of nitrogen fixer, but we're gonna let it get a little bit bigger before we start chopping on it. It's a little bit slower growing of a tree. And that's a long-term nitrogen fixer, so that'll live in the food forest for many, many years.
This is the Senna alata, the candlestick cassia, also a nitrogen fixer. There's a little dispute about that.
So they say.
It is a leguminous plant. And again, we're going to cut it just a little bit above the node, because that's where it's where roots come out, and it's also where buds and leaves form. So.
And if it stays warm this winter, which it normally does in Northeast Florida, although we can have some pretty cold winters, if it stays warm, this can regrow again. We could cut it even again and get even more biomass production out of this plant.
As you can see, it's some new growth.
Yeah, so these guys work for us, and we love these plants, and the fruit trees next door absolutely love these plants. So.
So you cut just above the node and at a slight angle, so when it rains, it's not sitting on top of the plant. This one's really easy for the sickle to handle. You just knock off the branches. Ooh. Like that, and don't hit anybody.
If you look at the seeds, there's literally thousands of these seeds floating around out here. And we just kind of toss them there, and that's the next crop. It's really simple. They sprout really easy, but it takes warmth to sprout. So they won't even begin to sprout until the soil warms back up in the spring and early summer. It's a pretty amazing plant. It knows when its temperature is just right, and then it really grows. They don't grow much over the winter. So that's why we're cutting them down now.
Air in there. You don't put anything right up against the trunk.
Yeah, you never want to have
rotting of the trunk.
You can see there's already cover crop coming up from just seeds that have fallen in there. So this is a nectarine, sunfire nectarine. It's
so good.
Delicious. This nectarine tree that we were just mulching, actually, he was encased, I mean, the canopy was actually surrounding him, so he wasn't getting a great deal of sunlight, which is okay in the heat of the summer here in Northeast Florida. It's almost subtropical in the summer, and it's very hot, and the trees actually like a little bit of shade, like dappled light is the best. So now that it's autumn and the temperatures are cooling off, we want this thing to get more sun, so we'll go in here, we'll clean up the canopy around it so the light shines in and this tree will grow out of it. So it's kind of like a protective phase. In the early part of the tree's life, they like a little canopy over them, but you come in here and you prune them out. We do that with all of our fruit trees. So we're about to do this basically around 50 or so trees within this food forest.
This is the Senna alata or candlestick cassia that we chopped a little bit over by the nectarine tree. And we cut this down maybe a month ago or a little bit longer even. And as you can see, the new growth is coming back already. And down here, you can see this is what's going to happen to what we chopped and dropped at the other place. It's going to turn into this brown, woody, carbonaceous mulch. And this breaks down into really good soil. So I don't know if you can come in and look at this, but we're talking about the sandy soil that Florida has. Look at this soil. We're not just lucky, we create this abundance. Look at that. Rich, rich soil. After this was chopped and dropped to build the soil, it also let in a lot of sunlight. And so we're able to plant some annual vegetable crops like the tomato, basil. We have some collards starting down here too. This is a little Asian pear that's getting started as well. So we're just stacking plants and speeding up succession. So we'll have a forest in 10 years instead of 150. We're gonna do an air layer, and we're gonna air layer this black locust tree, though you can do most any tree I'm aware of. And air layering is a fast way to get a tree, basically. Instead of starting from seed, and instead of doing a cutting, which usually are much smaller and may have trouble rooting, this way you root it on the plant before you cut it. And so you choose a branch that's relatively straight if you can, because this branch is gonna become the trunk of your tree. And what you do is you take some sort of pruners or knife and you score all the way around. All the way around. And then you do about an inch, inch and a half, and you score all the way around again. And then your next tool you'll need is some sort of pliers. And you take that part that you scored, you take it off the tree. So all the way around, it's completely stripped. So now you take moss. You could take moss from anywhere in your area or find some other substrate that will hold moisture, and you wrap it around the part that you've stripped. And now we're wrapping this aluminum foil around it. And if you find something else that will work to help keep the moisture in, go ahead and do that and let us know about it. But that's it. You just wrap it up, and this keeps the moisture in, and it allows the plant to grow roots right here. And depending on the plant, it can take from a few weeks up to a few months for it to grow roots in here. And you just check on it. And once it does have roots, you cut it below the roots and plant this in a pot or in the ground. And this is your new tree.
Once again, we're in an area of the garden that needs a little bit of maintenance, a little bit of chopping and dropping. This is a fruit tree behind me. It's a honeybell orange. It's only I think it's year four on this orange tree, going into the fourth year, and it's got fruit all over it. Honeybell delicious oranges. But the main part of this little segment is chopping and dropping. So we're gonna prune that tree back a little bit, and just cause it's encroaching upon the citrus tree, and we'll throw that at the base of the citrus tree. But what's so cool about this area is in the foreground here on the ground, you have these Senna allatas, and they're very prolific. And what we've been chopping and dropping them and mulching them, and these are all volunteers that actually seeded themselves out from a bush that's behind the camera. You guys can't see it. And it just drops tons of seeds everywhere. And so basically, this is our driveway. And if we pulled our cars out of this driveway, within a very short period of time, this area would re-pioneer itself and reforest itself with these plants. And there's also sweet potato on the ground here. We have a lot of cowpea around, mm-hmm. which is this stuff right here, cowpeas. And we have some bident alba, which is a local native plant to bring in bugs and insects. It's an insectary plant. So basically, this whole area would reforest itself without us doing anything at all. And eventually,
so in permaculture, it's called the edge effect.
This is the edge effect. The forest edge is extending out. And so, like I said, if we pulled out our cars, this would be covered with plants. And eventually, an orange will drop in there and start a new orange tree. And so it's building conditions favorable for forestry.
This is a moringa that's a few years old. And I just cut it yesterday, chopped and dropped. Up here. It didn't grow back already. This was just left over. But right here you can see this. We have a lot of rain, and then it's dry a little, and then a lot of rain, and it caused the moringa to crack. But it's still a really strong tree and keeps growing. This is the moringa that I chopped and dropped. And right next to it is the satsuma, and that's where most of the chopped and dropped plant pieces went.
Now, we chopped this tree back. It's a cherry laurel, and we like it in the summer because it gives us a lot of shade, but at this time of year, we want more sun, less shade. So we pruned off those branches, and we dropped them over here around specific fruit trees. For example, this is an apple tree, and apple trees do grow in Northeast Florida. This is a golden Dorset or an En Shamir apple, which is an Israeli variety, warm weather apple. And so we chopped back a lot of mulch and threw it down at the base. You can see it's quite thick. It's about a foot thick at the base of this tree. And this thing's just gonna love life. It's gonna process this over the winter. It's gonna rot down and turn into compost and feed this tree. We did the same thing with the same material on the tree behind it, which is starfruit, which is carambola. And star fruit does great as an understory in this climate, and it's doing quite well. Last year it made a lot of fruit. This year it's not making so much, and this is only 3 years old here, so it takes about 5 years to get good apples. But we're in the soil building phase, like we discussed before, and this is very much an important part of it. And if you dig around through all these layers of wood, you'll see just layers upon layers, and then when you get down to the bottom, you got good soil, and it's still moist. And I have to dig down through a lot. This plant here is called molokia. Some people call it molokia. In Arabic, that's how it's pronounced. It's the most widely eaten green in the Middle East. Some people call it Egyptian spinach. It's got many names. Common jute, like the string jute, is made out of the stalks of this plant. So if you're looking at a permaculture perspective on plants, you want to get as many uses as possible out of a plant. So this one gives you an amazing leaf crop. It's super rich in all kinds of minerals. It's molokia, M-O-L-O-K-I-A is the way it's spelled. Some people spell it that way. If you want to look it up and learn about this amazing plant. But it grows like a sea of green, and the hotter it gets, the better it grows. It's winding down now because we're getting into the fall. This when no other crop grows in this climate because it's too hot, this is the plant that flourishes. So traditionally, it's prepared into a stew in some sort of stock, and it's made into like a soup. And there's a lot of history behind this plant. King Moloch was very sick and dying, this ancient king, and a peasant brought him this plant, and he ate a soup consisting of this plant, and he got better. And ever since that, this has been like the most widely eaten green in that part of the world, so they say. But we like it a lot. It does really well. It's low maintenance. No bugs eat it. And then you can either chop it down and mulch it right on top of your annual gardens, which this is all our kitchen garden. Or you could take it and let it ripen on the vine, let it make seeds and collect seeds, and then harvest it for fiber production. And you just take the stalks and rub it between your hands and get the strings out of it, and you could weave it into rope or do whatever you want with it. It's a very useful plant and super delicious.
This plant is called shampoo ginger. It's a common name. We call it avapuhi in Hawaii. And the really cool thing about this plant is that it makes a liquid from the flower stalks here. It's like a Dr. Bronner's, and you can put on your hands and your face, and you don't even have to wash it off. It's just like this really refreshing liquid. But it's called shampoo ginger because it grows near riversides, and you can just wash your hair with it, jump in the river, and wash it off. This is a papaya variety from Echo down south in Sarasota. It's called Known You, and it's done really well here in Jacksonville. As you can see, these are pretty big papayas, and we still have a few months before the really hard cold sets in. So you can eat these green, grate them up, put ginger with them, ginger, lemon, salt. You can take these leaves, actually, and they make great straws. I don't know if you know that. So you can just cut a leaf, and then it's hollow inside, and make these biodegradable straws. This is another chop and drop plant. It's an elderberry, and it's already given us fruit. It's already flowered and fruited. And now, you know, winter's coming, and we can cut it about here, a little bit like head height, feed a fruit tree. It'll open up some light and some airflow to our annual vegetable garden in the back. So you can do a little back cut, again, just above the node. And then you have this big branch to break up. And a lot of these are really easy. Here's the apple tree, not very far. Just add it on top there. And all this will eventually break down and turn into soil. You won't even know that there were any branches there ever at all.
So what we have here is a Suriname cherry. And It's actually more suited towards a tropical climate. We're more of a warm, temperate, subtropical in the summer, but we get freezes and we get frosts in the winter, which is not good for this tree right here. It really likes warmth. So what we did is this part of our home faces south. And so the winter sun comes up and it beats on this brick wall behind here. And there's even a rain barrel back there, which holds even more heat. And when the sun beats on this wall, it gives that heat back off at night and warms up this area close to the house to where this area is a few degrees warmer than the surrounding area, and this tree won't frost. So the Suriname cherry, some people call them Brazil cherries, they're kind of resinous, and most people don't really care for them so much, and I don't understand why. They're absolutely delectable if you ever find them in your local markets, which if you're in the subtropics or tropics, you could definitely find them, but they don't ship well because they're kind of soft, so you won't find them at the local farmer's market so much. But when you're done eating them, you can save the seeds. That seed was so soft, I just ate the whole seed on that one. It wasn't fully developed, but you can save the seeds and actually throw them on the ground and they'll turn into a little Suriname cherry. Super delectable, super tangy, it's very sweet, much like a cherry, but a little bit more tart and a little bit more resinous. This one is called Jamaican sorrel. Some people call it cranberry hibiscus, and that name gets intertwined, so it's really hard to tell what is what. But this is a Caribbean, a very prominent food in the Caribbean, and you can eat the leaves. They're really tangy, like sorrel, much like sorrel. Super lemony, kind of tart. But the fun part about this plant is these little flowers, and it's not quite the flower. This is the flower right here. These are the flower buds. You can cut them off. And you can actually prune off the bottom. You can pop the seed out and you're left with this little maroon. It's a calyx actually, but it's a crunchy little, it tastes exactly like the leaf. And some chefs like to use them for garnish, but they're real crunchy and real tangy. You can probably hear the crunch. Super delicious, super high in vitamin C, great plant, super productive in this climate. The warmer it gets, the better it grows. Anybody can do this in any climate just because we're blessed with warm weather. I mean, people are getting snow already, and this time of the year is actually a good time to plant. So if you're in the coastal southeast, you know, winter crops are much more plentiful, and the bugs are a lot less of a problem at this time of year. So this is, we're getting into a good planting season, and you know, we just want to inspire everyone to maybe, you know, learn more about permaculture, watch a bunch of videos on the YouTube. There's tons of good information on there. Bill Mollison, Jeff Lawton, look up these people and learn from them, and you can have your own food forest and, you know, and not be so dependent on the local, you know, I mean, the food supply in this country is so shaky. Mm-hmm. And, you know, to be able to produce some of your own enzyme nutrient dense, we're talking about nutrient dense food here, which, right, which relates to health. So the better quality food that you eat, mm-hmm, that's locally grown, the healthier you're going to be.
And the best time to start is now, wherever you are, start now. It just builds upon itself. You just keep working it and keep expanding. Just start small. Keep adding to what you're doing, and you'll keep building your soil. The ecosystem will start mending itself.
It's pretty amazing. After about 3.5 to 4 years, you really see things start to take off. It's a little bit of work the first year or two, and then things get easier and easier, and you learn more too. You make a lot of mistakes, and learning.
The key is there's light at the end of the tunnel. It's not like every year is the same, and the same hard work, and the same weeds, and you don't want to go out there anymore because it's just more of the same. So with permaculture, your food system keeps growing, it keeps maturing. It's like your baby grows up and it's finally able to take care of itself.
And just to be able to support yourself with that nutrient dense food, it's key for everything. You know, healthcare is a big issue, and you know,
This is your healthcare.
You created a giant biofilter to clean toxins out of the environment and, you know, put them back into carbon pathways in the soil and store them there, to where, you know, these things aren't a problem anymore. Anyone can do this, and it's we can teach you how to do it. You can watch more videos about how to do this, and you know, we wish you the best of luck. Please plant a food forest.
All the solutions are in the garden.